most difficult and complicated operation ever to take place. Winston Churchill. The destruction of the enemy's landing is the sole decisive factor in the whole conduct of the war, and hence in its final results. Adolf Hitler. The history of war does not know of an undertaking comparable to it for breadth of conception, grandeur of scale, and mastery of execution. Joseph Stalin. Good luck, and let us all beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking. Dwight D. Eisenhower, Order of the Day, June 4, 1944.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents D-Day, June 6, 1944. The Climactic Battle of World War II. By Stephen Ambrose. Read by Jesse Boggs.
Prologue. At 0016 hours, June 6, 1944, the Horsa glider crash-landed alongside the Caen Canal, some 50 meters from the swing bridge crossing the canal. Lieutenant Den Brotheridge, leading the 28 men of the 1st Platoon, D Company, the Oxfordshire and Buckinghamshire Light Infantry Regiment, British 6th Airborne Division, worked his way out of the glider. He grabbed Sergeant Jack Bill Bailey, a section leader, and whispered in his ear, "Get your chaps moving." Bailey set off with his group to pitch grenades into the machine gun pillbox known to be beside the bridge. Lieutenant Brotheridge gathered the remainder of his platoon, whispered, "Come on, lads," and began running for the bridge. The German defenders of the bridge, about 50 strong, were not aware that the long-awaited invasion had just begun. As Brotheridge led his men at a fast trot up the embankment and onto the bridge, 17-year-old Private Helmut Romer, one of the two German sentries on the bridge, saw the 21 British paratroopers, appearing, so far as he was concerned, literally out of nowhere, coming at him, their weapons carried at their hips, prepared to fire. Romer turned and ran across the bridge, shouting, "Paratroopers!" at the other sentry as he passed him. That sentry pulled out his Leuchtpistole and fired a flare. Brotheridge fired a full clip of 32 rounds from his Sten gun. Those were the first shots fired by the 175,000 British, American, Canadian, Free French, Polish, Norwegian, and other nationalities in the Allied Expeditionary Force set to invade Normandy in the next 24 hours. The shots killed the sentry, who thus became the first German to die in defense of Hitler's fortress Europe. Brotheridge, 26 years old, had been training for this moment for 2 years, and for the specific task of seizing the bridge by a coup de main operation for 6 months. He had come up from the ranks. His company commander, Major John Howard, had recommended him for the OCTU, Officer Cadet Training Unit, back in 1942. His fellow platoon officers were university graduates, if not rich, at least well-to-do. If not aristocrats, at least upper class. And at first they were a bit uneasy when Brotheridge returned as an officer because he wasn't one of us, you know. Brotheridge played soccer, not cricket. He was a first-class athlete, good enough that it was freely predicted he would become a professional soccer player after the war. He got on easily with the men and had no sense at all of that vast gulf that so often separates British subalterns from the enlisted men. Brotheridge would go into the barracks at night, sit on the bed of his Batman, Billy Gray, and talk soccer with the lads. He would bring his boots along and shine them as he talked. Private Wally Parr never got over the sight of a British lieutenant polishing his boots while his Batman lay back on his bed, gassing on about Manchester United and West Ham and other soccer teams. Den Brotheridge was a lanky, laughing, likable sort of chap, and his fellow officers warmed to him. Everyone admired him. He was fair, conscientious, hard-driving, quick to learn, a master at all the weapons in the company, an able teacher and an apt pupil, a natural leader. When Major Howard selected Brotheridge as leader of the 1st Platoon, the other lieutenants in the company agreed that Den was the right man to lead the first troops to go into action on D-Day. Brotheridge was as good as any junior officer in the British Army, among the best the country had produced to fight for its freedom in the life and death struggle. Brotheridge had more at stake in the struggle than most, for he was one of the few married men in D Company, and his wife, Margaret, was 8 months pregnant. So he had had an unborn child's future on his mind during the flight over the English Channel. Romer's shout, the Leuchtpistole flare, and Brotheridge's Sten gun combined to pull the German troops manning the machine gun pits and the slit trenches on both sides of the bridge into full alert. They began opening fire from their Maschinengewehr, MG-34, and their Gewehrs and Karabiners, rifles and carbines. Brotheridge, almost across the bridge, his platoon following, the men firing from their hips, pulled a grenade out of his pouch and threw it at the machine gun pit to his right. As he did so, he was knocked over by the impact of a bullet in his neck. He fell forward. His platoon ran past him, with two other platoons from two other gliders close behind. The men of D Company cleared out the machine gun pits and slit trenches in short order. By 0021, the enemy in the immediate vicinity of the bridge had either been killed or had run off. Private Parr went looking for Brotheridge, who was supposed to set up his command post at a café beside the bridge. "Where's Danny?" Parr asked another private. To his face, the men all called him Mr. Brotheridge. The officers called him Den. But the men thought of him and referred to him as Danny. "Where's Danny?" Parr repeated. The private did not know. Parr ran to the front of the café. He found Brotheridge lying on the ground in the road opposite the café. His eyes were open and his lips were moving, but Parr could not make out what he was saying. Parr thought, "What a waste. All the years of training we put in to do this job, it lasted only seconds, and there he lies." Stretcher-bearers carried Brotheridge back across the bridge to an aid station. The company doctor, John Vaughan, found the wounded lieutenant, quote, "lying on his back, looking up at the stars and looking terribly surprised, just surprised." Vaughan gave him a shot of morphine and began to dress the bullet hole in the middle of his neck. Before he could complete the first aid, Brotheridge died. He was the first Allied soldier to be killed by enemy fire on D-Day. Lieutenant Robert Mason Mathias was the leader of the 2nd Platoon, E Company, 508th Parachute Infantry Regiment, U.S. 82nd Airborne Division. At midnight, June 5 and 6, 1944, he was riding in a C-47 Dakota over the English Channel, headed toward the Cotentin Peninsula of Normandy. 2 hours later, the plane was over France and started to take some flak from German guns. At 0227 hours, Lieutenant Mathias saw the red light go on over the open door of the plane, the signal to get ready. "Stand up and hook up!" Lieutenant Mathias called out to the 16 men behind him as he hooked the clip from his parachute to the static line running down the middle of the roof of the aircraft. He stepped to the open door, ready to jump the instant the pilot decided the plane was over the drop zone and turned on the green light. The Germans below were firing furiously at the air armada of 822 C-47s, carrying the 82nd and 101st Airborne Divisions into battle. Flak-Fierling 38s, 20mm four-barreled anti-aircraft guns, filled the sky with explosions. Machine gun tracers, green, yellow, red, blue, white, arched through the sky. The sight was at once awesome. Nearly every paratrooper thought this was the grandest 4th of July fireworks display he had ever seen, and terrifying. For every visible tracer, there were 5 unseen bullets. Unseen, but not unheard. The bullets rattled against the wings of the C-47s, sounding like rocks being shaken in a tin can.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.